talk about battery when it comes to wireless, battery life, spectrum, Internet of Things, all these different things that could be barriers to mobile adoption and wireless adoption. But one of the main questions is that, and it doesn't seem to be changing anytime soon, advertising. Advertising is fueling our mobile experiences, our internet experiences, and the question is advertising on mobile going to fuel all the issues that we've been talking about today? So to answer that question, we have
Eric John, who's a senior director at the Interactive Advertising Bureau, and Eric is going to take this panel through its paces. Thank you.
Thank you. So there's an old truism that says, wherever eyeballs go, the money flows. And this panel is going to be all about that dynamic. We have a great group of people here, really excited to have with us Pete Chelala, who is Vice President of Video Advertising Sales at Viacom. We have Ryan McConville going down the line, President and COO of Kargo. We have Chris Klotzbach, Head of Product Marketing at Yahoo, Flurry. And then Alexandra Hardiman from New York Times, who heads up mobile products. So if you would, I'm just going to ask you each to say what you do day to day, and then we'll launch into our first couple of questions.
So following smart cities and Internet Barbie, I can't compete with that. I would say whenever you guys watch a video on everything but live television on Viacom properties, which is Nickelodeon all the way to TV land, as Eric likes to say, from diapers to diapers, I'm the guy putting the commercial in front of your face. When you hit play to watch content and you see a commercial, you're welcome.
You're welcome. I'm not sure you made any friends there. So I'm Ryan McConville. I'm the president and CEO of Kargo. Kargo is a creative mobile advertising company. We do a number of things, but I think what our sort of mission is to invent new ad formats for the mobile screen. So I think some of the issues with ad blocking that we're seeing is that we're taking sort of legacy assets, desktop banners or television commercials, and trying to squeeze them onto this small screen. And our company believes that you have to create sort of new formats specifically for the mobile phone, new creative formats that work specifically in that medium. So we work with brand advertisers to create new creative ideas to work specifically for mobile phones.
My name is Chris Klotzbach, and I lead marketing and developer relations for Flurry Analytics and the Yahoo Mobile Developer Suite. So Flurry Analytics was launched in 2008 and is installed in over 800,000 mobile applications. So we're a free analytics tool that app developers use to understand how users are engaging in the app experience and hopefully grow their businesses to engage them.
Hi, and I'm Alex Hardiman. I oversee the news products team at the New York Times. So news products is essentially the digital expression of the New York Times on web, app, off-platform. So if you ever read the New York Times through Apple News or Facebook Instant Articles. We've also been playing around with some new ventures like virtual reality and audio.
So there's a study from Deloitte that says the average American picks up their phone 42 times a day. How many people feel like that's too low of a number? I'm personally about 200 times a day. ComScore, who analyzes a lot of audience behavior across screens, says that the average American now represents 2 out of 3 digital minutes on the mobile device. And while websites were the original primary medium for online interaction, now dedicated smartphone apps capture nearly half of all of our time spent. So if you look at all these behaviors together, the imperative is for brands to become mobile first, but that's easier said than done. So I want to open this up with a question for each of you. Putting mobile at the forefront requires a lot of careful consideration. How do you advise your clients, Pete, in how to become mobile first?
It's a great question, because some are way more advanced than others. I mean, I work with the Taco Bells all the way to the H&R Blocks, and everybody wants to target the younger audience, the millennials. There's 100 million of them. There's 45 million in the workplace. They grew up with living with digital. They're the digital native, right? So Viacom is built on the economy of attention, right? So half of my company monetizes attention that the other half goes out and grabs. And that is happening a lot today on alternative screens. meaning mobile, tablet, over-the-top devices for television, like the gaming console, Apple TV, Roku. But I think any client who I work with, they understand their audience as much as we understand ours. So to not think that they're living in the mobile world, they'd be out of a job, right? So they're already coming to the table thinking, you know, how do we actually reach our fans? And we help them, you know, get in their path. So we have to enable them by making it easy. It's like the smart cities talked about. You have to innovate, you have to collaborate, and then you have to make it simple to actually transact. The more hurdles you give them, the harder it is to get them to actually move their dollars there and reach their audience. So I work across the whole mix of screens, but you know, we love mobile because, again, if you look at everyone in the room today, not one of us forgot our phone at home, right? We're always on. So long form TV, having a cadence with a conversation with an audience every day, it's happening all day long, not just at prime time anymore. So it gives us more reach, and it gives us our clients the ability to talk to their customer any time of day, anywhere they are.
Ryan, you work with both publishers and advertisers, a lot of the biggest brands out there. How are you consulting with them, you know, to be mobile first?
I think the first thing that we're telling them is that mobile's different. So it's sort of like my intro. This isn't just a new place where eyeballs are, it's a completely different medium. So one stat that I tell brand advertisers a lot, 30% of people in the United States think of mobile advertising as an invasion of their personal space. There's no other medium, billboards, newspapers, televisions, where ads have existed before, where people felt that way about the advertising. So brands have to be different in how they think about it. 4 out of 5 teens sleep with their phones. Not next to their phones, like with their phones. The average teenager will text 45 text messages, for those of you who have teenagers, after they turn out the lights and go to sleep. So when you put an ad on this device, you know, you are talking to someone in a really intimate way. And so you have to rethink your approach. And again, it's not about taking your TV commercial and jamming it on here, or taking your desktop banner ad and jamming it on here. It's about literally recreating new experiences that work more intuitively with this new medium. So it's sort of, when we talk to brands and publishers, it's really about saying you have to be willing to put in the work and rethink this in order to get the right experience out of it.
We've measured out, just to go back to your initial point, we've measured that the average U.S. user, despite age group or not, spends over 4 hours a day on their smartphone, and that's up from 0 hours a day in 2007. So there's been massive adoption of smartphones and applications to that point. And to echo your point there, we really believe that you need to meet the user in their environment and understand how they're engaging on their phones on a daily basis. So this past year, we found that social and messaging applications are dominating users' time spent. And specifically, or beyond just communicating with their friends and family there, they're distributing and discovering content. So if you have a message that you want to share to your users and your consumers, you have to think about how to take advantage of that behavior and the massive amount of time that everyone is spending in a social and messaging application. So it's really about understanding the user and the use case and then building your strategy around that.
Alex, what is the New York Times audience like today on mobile? You've got a brand, how old now? It's literally one of the most storied brands out there.
Like over 150 years old, yeah.
So what is that, how do you address that mobile consumer and bring your brands along on the journey?
Yeah, I mean, so a little bit about my job. I actually don't just work on advertising. I have the really awesome job of taking the way that we produce news, the way that we think about new ad formats, the way that we think about marketing, thinking about the layer of user experience and the underlying technologies, and trying to wrap it into an application that feels like a whole thing that actually does meet, as many of you guys have said, real reader needs or user needs. And so what we've done is actually thought about mobile formats for advertising in the same way that we think about mobile formats for the newsroom. And are we gonna look at a few examples at some point?
Because
we don't have to do it right now, but some of what you'll see, we actually looked at mobile formats and user needs and saw that they were actually pretty different versus, say, traditional desktop needs. Some of the things that you'll look at on the slides, we know that the Moment, for instance, we actually have two moments on mobile that never exist on desktop. People first, you guys know this, you wake up, you have your phone on your desktop table, pick it up and you want to see literally did the world blow up or not. The second morning for you might be on your commute when you're trying to get caught up on the headlines. You want to see essentially, you know, am I going to be smart at work today? Do I know what's going on for the dinner table conversation? Those are the exact same problems that both we from a newsroom perspective try to meet with formats and that advertisers do as well. So you really want to try to take that idea of adjacent interruptive ads and really ban it from mobile. But in order to really have a proper place in the stream alongside editorial content, advertising has to be that much better. And that's really our belief, that we can share the same formats, the same templates, the same visual language between editorial and advertising content, as long as it is very, very clearly differentiated, and we believe that the advertising is deserving of readers' time.
So let's stay on formats for a second. I think I'm forgetting who it was. We talked about this earlier last week, and someone said, you know, two or three years ago, advertisers were saying, listen, you know, mobile just doesn't work for us anymore. But that has evolved, you know, and I think formats have evolved. So I actually have a couple of creative examples. If we could start actually, Chris, with you, and give us a quick, assuming this works.
Yeah, so to that point, we work with a lot of marketers that two or three years ago have, you know, tried to leverage mobile advertising, but at that point it was really just taking a desktop banner and shoving it into the mobile experience. And users rejected that, they abandoned the experience, they didn't engage with those ads, or at least didn't engage on purpose. So what we found with the app developers we work with is that native and video formats work particularly well on mobile, and they increase engagement in the ad experience, and they are less intrusive to the actual app or mobile web experience for the user. So at Yahoo, we've identified two formats, native formats that work particularly well. The first is the pencil format, so that's like the thin in-stream unit that's either that you find on your pages, and then also the card, which is the larger format with a rich image. The great thing about native formats and what native really means is that it's a ad format that fits the form and function of the page. It's built in. It's built in to emulate the way that the user is engaging in that app experience. We're very, very sensitive to marking the ad as if it is an ad and saying that this is sponsored or this is a paid piece of content. But really, it's an enriched ad experience that, you know, is benefiting both the publisher in its performance and the advertiser because they're seeing that performance increase, and the user because they are, you know, not getting a big, flashy, ugly banner in their face.
Brian, your company specializes in kind of the richest examples of mobile advertising. I've got a couple of examples here. If we could just cycle through quickly and share us your approach.
So just one thing I wanted to say. So there's the user experience, and then there's also the advertiser, and then there's the publisher, right? And right now, the ad agencies of the world only want to pay the publisher if the ad is seen, right? Which seems fair, probably. But the problem with all native formats is the way that we use our screens. So the average user session in mobile is 60 seconds, okay? The scroll velocity, and they measure such things now, can range in social feeds from 230 pixels per second in Facebook to about 50 pixels per second in content like the New York Times as people are reading. Scroll depth, how far down a page you get before you abandon the page is also different. In entertainment, when you're reading about Kim Kardashian, if no one in this room, I'm sure, reads about Kim Kardashian. You read like the first few headlines and you're gone. On the New York Times or the Guardian or something, people will scroll way down the page. So just as a prelude to some of these examples, not every ad format is actually is right for every publisher. So native formats are great for news, but some of the other more persistent, like a what we call a sticky banner, which is non-intrusive, but is persistent and sits at the top of the page, may be required for entertainment publishers to stay in business because the scroll depths don't ever allow you to get to the native ad. So it's not as simple as make a big ad or make a small ad. You have to take into account the category you're in, the scroll depth, the scroll velocity, and then what everyone's trying to get out of it, the user experience, the advertiser who's trying to show their brand in a positive way, and the publisher who's trying to make a living. And we really try to account for all of those things by creating creative ads that are, you know, we use the word dazzle. It's, you know, in this cynical world of advertising, it's probably hard to achieve, but we try to do things that sort of utilize the technology of the phone to kind of dazzle the user a little bit without sort of trying to jump in their face. So we try to blend all of those things in the right mixture. Great.
Pete, how do you guys approach the user experience on Viacom? Quickly.
I think if you go back to dazzle, I think I served one of my first mobile ads in 2005 on Weather Channel. Like a WAP protocol page on like a on deck.
That was dazzling.
It was a static Amex ad, and people were like, "This is incredible! It's the future," and it was, because fast forward to 2008, around there, there was actually an ad in Variety, the app Variety's app, and when you touched the screen of your phone with your fingers, it left bloody fingerprints behind, and then it just bled down a video for the True Blood promo.
And people said,
"Oh, cool."
And people
started downloading the app to play with the ad, because, you know, if you think about rich media interactive ads on the internet, you know, you need a car to drive by your face to take you from your email and the news to where the ad is, because there's so much going on the page. But when you actually go, if you go to the screen over here, if you look at some of the real estate people have, it's a full entire screen dedicated to a message that, you know, tap your co-pilot here. People weren't saying tap here 5 years ago. Now you just tap. It's what you do. And then when you look at that page, it's giving you reviews from customers. It's giving you products. The next one is a quiz that lets our millennials, you know, show off that they're smart. Take a quiz, prove you're cool, send it to your friends, you're smart. But that's actually, this could live across multiple screens. That's just how it looks. It's spawned from an ad at the top of a page. The last one, the storyboard unit, takes in all the types of formats and expressions that we're used to today. Animated GIFs, video, tutorials, all that lives in one large screen, in-your-face kind of experience. Again, we're consumer first. We want to make sure you actually can see our content. So this lives between pages, or it's user-initiated. Nothing's forced. We actually mirror our apps after TV, not desktop, so that you come here, hit play, and enjoy The Daily Show or Team Mom or, you know, 16 and Pregnant or whatever else you guys are into. Jake, skip to the next one, because this is what's happening that's new, right? We put the 30-second spot within long-form content. But when you show up to Snapchat now, and the advertiser has the same real estate as the content publisher, the content creator, now it's a different game, right? So now we're actually helping our clients create content for their ad, serve it within the 10-second frame. You actually can swipe up. If Jake hits play, he'll see that it'll swipe up and then give you up to 10 minutes of more content. And that's within a Snapchat experience.
Real quick, how many people here use Snapchat?
Look at that. Look at that. Right? So when you're in Discover, Comedy Central and MTV have their own channels. Jake, we're cool, man. It's all good. I promise you. We have to make sure, to Ryan's point, that when you're speaking to a fan in an environment like Snapchat, that you're speaking that platform's language, because otherwise you're out, right? You're either in or you're out. So we're very good at talking to fans no matter what the platform is, and it's our job, again, to make it easy for them to activate against this audience, and that means doing the work.
Yep. Alex, the New York Times audience is not necessarily the Snapchat audience today.
Are you saying we're less fun?
Yeah.
I think you're right.
So will the Times be on Snapchat? Is that what you're saying?
I could probably prove you wrong on that, actually. Yeah.
Well, his mother is a snapper.
Yeah. She snaps more than me.
So it's an interesting question. It's clearly changing the way people are consuming content and advertising. It's flipping video vertically.
Yeah, and we actually have a lot of reporters who are doing some incredible investigative stuff, even just chronicling like polluted water and other things on Snapchat. It's actually pretty fun.
Yeah.
Anyhow, New York Times, do you mind? Thanks. This is just, it's unfortunately really impossible to see. Just, Let's just skip past this one. Awesome.
What do you mean? Success?
Looks like all of these are actually terrible. So here's the gist. We know essentially when people come on mobile, and we want to make sure that advertising is incredibly useful for those moments. So this notion of mobile-driven programming is the same thing that's guiding editorial decisions within the newsroom and a lot of the ad creative that we are helping to build with advertisers. So you can think in the morning about service-oriented advertising and journalism around stock markets, weather, et cetera. And this has helped breed a new format for us called Flex Frames. And this slide just shows that one of the things that was really important for us was efficiency. So we wanted to make sure that we could come up with something that was scalable across web and app, worked on a bunch of different formats across iOS, Android, mobile web, and really just brought a lot of value and utility at the end of the day. If you don't mind going to the next one. So this is just an example of Volvo. And we've done, again, a lot of different really interesting campaigns that take advantage of, you know, video, slideshows, other side swipers, so things that have proven to deepen engagement within our own editorial content. We were able to parlay those over into ad units. But again, the branding, the logos, everything is so clearly labeled advertising that we're actually seeing that readers like to spend time with this type of ad content. So click-throughs and engagement rates are about 4 to 5 times higher than what we've seen with traditional ad formats. And same thing with surveys and other qualitative information. We find that our readers actually like this. Which is a pretty big change from traditional banner ads. Okay, are any of you guys home delivery subscribers to the New York Times? Awesome. Did you last November get this bizarre, awesome little box? Google Cardboard? You guys remember that? Okay. Yeah, right, did you actually use it? Okay, so we did this really incredible program. We distributed about 1 million Google Cardboard units to home delivery subscribers across the country. And we created 2 new apps, an iOS app and an Android app. And this is the opening scene from the Displaced film, which chronicled 3 migrant children in war-torn countries. So not the lightest film, but it was a classic example of really hard-hitting journalism, nonfiction that just blended so well in terms of the narrative form of VR. And it's kind of a cliched term at this point, but for those of you who might have experienced the video, you had more empathy for those children after 8 minutes spent with them in VR than I think you would have had with most films. So when we were talking to sponsors or advertisers about what we could do to bring their messages in, we immediately knew that we had to toss out the idea of pre-roll. It just didn't make any sense. So we spoke to Mini, GE, and a few others and created really high quality, powerful VR standalone films. So the ad to edit ratio in terms of films in the app is about 1-to-1, which is kind of unheard of as well. And we've actually seen that some of the advertiser videos have had more streams than some of our own editorial videos. It's really, really different from what you would normally see. So this is, again, while it doesn't provide the scale of something like our flex frame units, it's very much the model that we want to take for advertising going forward, where we bring in really great brand advertisers and our ad team at the table with editors, designers, technologists, product folks, et cetera, to figure out how to make advertising not suck. And this was something that we were really proud of.
We had Lee Nadler from BMW Mini come and present, and this was probably the biggest advertiser that I've seen, fully both feet firmly printed in, or planted in the VR world. There's a lot of activity in the space. But let's stay on video for a second, because a couple of interesting stats. Snapchat recently announced 8 billion daily video views, matching Facebook's publicly stated numbers of 8 billion. You've got a deal like Twitter, where they recently announced that they'll be on your mobile phone broadcasting the NFL. So clearly, live sports, long-form video, it's all going to the mobile device. And the good news is that's where the money is. Do you think the higher CPMs of video are going to be the saving grace for mobile revenue?
I mean, it's a tricky question,
yeah,
right? Because clients don't want to pay higher CPMs, right?
That's your job to convince them.
When they want, I don't work at a mobile company. I work at a content company, and we are on every screen that's possibly out there that our fans need to be on. So that's televisions, that's OTT, it's everything you can think of. And it's obviously more money per 1,000 impressions in the digital space because it's on demand, it's more targeted, all that kind of stuff. It's up for negotiation, I would say. We definitely are expensive and more expensive than television. But it's a negotiation. We have upfronts for that every year to talk about volume and price efficiencies. But For us, our goal is to make sure the content is good enough to grab attention, and for doing that, the money will follow.
I kind of feel like I beat on the same theme, but just to sort of reimagine how video is monetized in mobile and how it might be different. Again, we think of television. You know, we used to sit down and watch 30-minute long sitcoms, and then you'd have 30-second non-skippable pre-rolls. The other day, Kargo kind of relaunched its branding, actually. And the brand now sort of exists in a frame. And one of the millennials on the marketing team said, why don't we buy a Snapchat geofilter? Some of you guys know what the geofilters are, but you could actually buy a Snapchat geofilter for Kargo that was basically just the radius of our New York block. So what happened was, when we relaunched the brand on that day, we told everyone in the office that this geofilter was available. So of course, what they all did was they took videos of each other, they overlaid the Kargo geofilter, and then they posted it on Snapchat. And what you had was Snapchat monetizing user-created video with Kargo branding and pushing it out. And that's a video monetization that is going to be a booming business for Snapchat. It has nothing to do with an advertorial pre-roll. It's this weird, and unless you've seen what a geofilter looks like, you probably can't even imagine it. It's a weird overlay that sits on top of user-generated video. But tons of advertisers are using this now as a way to sort of sponsor viral video. And I think that if you include that in the mix, I think you start to see more of the future of mobile video than just thinking again about putting commercials on mobile screens.
Just to add in there, I don't think any client today is thinking about one ad product to reach their consumer today, right? I think video is one arrow in the quiver. Social is a different arrow in the quiver. They may look at Snapchat as a video destination or a social destination, and that depends on where their budget sits. But you know, you have to be able to, I think as a publisher today, have to be able to react to every way they want to buy in the industry. And I think the fact that we actually use Kargo, we tap into Flurry, I love the New York Times. But again, you can't look at approaching a client with one arrow in today's industry.
Yeah, no, I agree with both those statements. Like, I don't think that one format is going to be the saving grace. You know, as you have to just look to user and consumer behavior, eyeballs are shifting to these devices. Cord cutting is no longer like something that's going to happen in the future. It's happening now. You see, you know, major legacy, huge businesses adjusting to that, like HBO. So as eyeballs shift and attention shift to smartphones, and that's the way that we're consuming media and entertainment, you know, advertising dollars are going to follow.
We were talking earlier as a group, you know, there is such a demand for video. There really is a supply and demand issue. And, you know, you think everyone talks about advertising in terms of the video and the opportunity for revenue, but the kind of unspoken challenge is also, how do you scale the inventory? How do you take, you know, for instance, you know, Alex in the New York Times, can you take a journalist and make them a video journalist? How do you guys think about video at the New York Times?
So full disclosure, this is very much a year of experimentation for us. We actually disbanded most of our video team, and we're rebuilding the team back up. So we are playing with a mix of live content and pre-programmed video. We're looking at on-platform and off-platform to see what that distributed business looks like. Shorter segments versus longer programmed series. And part of it is bringing in fresh new talent that is expert. Part of it, we actually do have a lot of people who can be cross-skilled into becoming, you know, excellent video journalists. But for us, I think we really have to prove that we can create, and I know we believe we can, but this is the year for us to show incredible scale with quality content that will then lead to much better advertising.
Can I just also, there is absolutely a myth of mobile video, I think, that at least I believe in. So first of all, a lot on the mobile devices, you have iTunes, you have Netflix, you have subscription-based video consumption. So there's a lot of video that's consumed that is not even ad-supported. So this sort of dream that all this pre-roll is going to come into the mobile devices, like, I think it's a little misplaced. The other thing that you have is user-generated video. So when Facebook says they have 8 billion video views, that is not people watching TV shows on Facebook, right? That is, you know, someone pouring water over their head in the bucket challenge. Same on Snapchat. Same on YouTube. Again, when you are about to consume a 30-second video, there's no, like, user-generated video, you're not going to watch a 30-second ad, right? It's just, it's double the amount of time of the actual content you're going to consume. So when you go on Facebook and you go through their video libraries, you're not seeing tons of pre-rolls. So what they're doing is they're posting videos, I think, more like the New York Times is doing with the virtual reality as content next to the other videos. But even though there's this sort of large video supply in some cases, it doesn't mean that there's all this room for traditional pre-roll video. And I think that's what sort of the industry thinks is eventually going to happen. And I don't think it will happen that way. I think, again, to use the geofilter example, like these companies are going to have to create new ways of monetizing the video supply that are more appropriate for mobile.
I think for us, and I agree with everybody, obviously, but you know, again, we are a content company. We are using Hulu and YouTube and Snapchat like we use Comcast, Fios, Time Warner Cable, right? So we have the right deals in place to then reaggregate our audience. So we have full control of our 7 YouTube channels where Key and Peele did 1 billion video views. Our lip sync battle with LL Cool J does just gangbusters. Every night it's on, it kills, it trends. And we can now monetize that because we made it. So it's not UGC, it's not going to be cats with kittens. It's going to be content that fans love, share, and watch over and over again that we can put our clients in front of. And the same goes with Hulu. It's something they're comfortable watching. It's in-stream video, and you know, I think it's about 20% of Hulu's on mobile, half of YouTube's on mobile. We're seeing our growth to desktop go underneath mobile viewing. So there's a lot of mobile viewing, and it is right now for us in long form. And I like that because we can move money from television with Nielsen and Comscore ratings, with the GRPs that we can pull. And we can obviously either transact in viewability or demo, but that gets money from TV where there's billions of dollars being spent, billions, moving into mobile where it was pennies.
So right. let's talk about measurement for a second.
One thing real quick. Well, you have long form shifting onto mobile, and Pete and Alex, cover your ears. To your point, UGC is, everyone is a content creator now. Everyone, right? A year ago, it was people that were investing in creating YouTube videos. Like, as Pete mentioned, my mom is a content creator and distributing her video content through Snapchat. So it's an interesting dilemma for marketers because for the longest time, UGC is a bad word. But as we all create more content and consume more UGC content, we're going to have to find ways to monetize and engage our marketers with that content.
I was just going to say, picking up on the GRP question, you know, it's you can't sell what you can't measure, right? And so the question I have is, you know, desktop, you could call that a mature a mature business, but the reality is on mobile, we've kind of ported over so much of that business into mobile, including the, you know, the way we hew to clicks. Why has it taken so long for us to kind of evolve our metrics, and what do you think are the right metrics to leverage in mobile so that there is more of an opportunity for brands to understand how they're interacting?
Can actually only because I feel like Pete set this one up really well. This meme of mobile pennies, we kind of have to kill it. Mm-hmm. And there was actually, you guys probably saw, an analyst at Andreessen Horowitz did a little bit of number crunching and realized that, yes, back in 2012, Facebook's engagement among their users was much less than what they were seeing on desktop. It's totally flipped now in terms of engagement and average revenue per user. Yes, they are Facebook. We are not all going to be Facebooks. But there is this moment. I mean, again, you're talking about 45 plus times people are picking up their smartphone per day. If we continue to invest in excellent mobile-first or mobile-only content, we will see the engagement and the money come. It's a different model entirely, but I don't think that we should give up hope. If anything, we just actually have to band together and be, I think, really willing to test, do some crazy shit stuff. Excuse me.
New York Times, that's right.
Censored. Are we all like a 5 second away?
I just thought that would come out of you.
Right. Free democracy.
Fucked up.
And but we can figure this out. And there's actually something about mobile that I think gives us a moment to look at alternative revenue models as well. So I think when we look at engagement, there's a pretty big moment for us to be doubling down on well past a click.
I think once you see Snapchat introduce DAR, which is the Nielsen version for demo, mm-hmm. there's money going to flow there. I mean, that's the current, people are not going to pay you for something in volume without a currency. And that's going to be either demo or viewability. And I think, I mean, Snapchat's a great example. They are only mobile. They are vertical video. They changed that whole, they changed everything from landscape to vertical. Verizon launches a new app. It's going to change the world. It's called Go 90, which means go landscape. And then they can't compete now with vertical.
But hang on. So Snapchat, vertical video, all you can do is watch it. There is no call to action. There is no next step. And we're all about, at the IAB, we're really focused on attribution. I mean, part of that mission right now in talking with advertisers is, okay, so I spent all these, I pushed all these impressions, now what? Has it actually informed what's happened in store, et cetera? So where, if video is purely, you know, a visual and no next step, how do you do attribution?
That's up to for Snapchat to figure out. I'm curious. I'm the same way. I'm curious the same way. You can't tap through and make a next step.
And you can say television is the same, right?
I'll tell you right now. People, I think our clients can't ignore the volume that we're seeing in there. And if you're first, it's an innovative space. It's not. They're not putting all their money there. They are testing there. But if you are, think about how noisy our life is with advertising. I mean, there's no more clean space. It's all ads. So if you're actually going to advertise in a new kind of platform, a new landscape, then you're going to be the first one there. You're going to have a land grab. Someone's going to actually see your message. Most people come to me anyway for top of the funnel. They're not trying to get you to go buy movie tickets from that ad. We help create demand, and there's plenty of places to harvest that demand. But people aren't ignoring the volume. They're not.
Yeah, I would say measurement. I don't think measurement's been bad in mobile for the people who have been doing mobile advertising. So there's a lot of business, like Facebook's business is largely still driven by app downloads. I mean, even though the brand business is coming, you guys look in your Facebook feeds, it's mostly like, I see lots of VC-backed Silicon Valley, like startup companies trying to sell me an app download for some new workflow tool usually. But that's all measured, they pay when it and you install. So the measurement's perfect, right? For brands, it is a little bit harder, but there's a bunch of companies that are either interesting or, you know, depending on what your side you're on, scary from a sort of a data tracking perspective, right? And that's one of the things that the IAB looks at. But there's anonymized aggregate attribution models that can track store traffic. So you saw an ad and your device like later went into a store. There are companies like Datalogix that can track you back to SKU purchases. There are companies like Nielsen Catalina that can do the same thing. Now, Apple has made it very difficult by kind of really interrupting the ability of cookies to properly recognize that you're the same person in these different environments, because they don't allow persistent cookies like desktop. So that's been a bit of a challenge, but device IDs inside apps are fairly persistent. I don't know if mobile has such a huge measurement problem as it just has maybe not done a good job educating the amount of measurement that is available. I'm sure you would even know
more. Chris, you see a ton of engagement data, you know, through your installed platform of partners.
Yeah, well, no, I think that, so as I said earlier, there's a huge portion of population spending more and more time in social and messaging applications. And we've noticed that, you know, social engagement and distribution has become a huge sort of metric of success for a number of marketers, especially if they're trying to, share a brand message. So I think getting a little bit smarter of, okay, it's not a click on the ad, but say, you know, on Tumblr, you show a really incredible interactive native ad experience, and then it's distributed and shared through that network and then amplified through the platform. So I think there's interesting ways to track against social sharing. People on those social and messaging applications, 70% of their time is consuming content. Like, I'm going to get slapped on the hand, but, you know, the search bar and the browser is swiftly sort of diminishing in terms of how you discover content. People are finding it on social networks. So as a marketer, you want to be able to take advantage of that. And it's very, very easily tracked through their platforms or through your own analytics or solution. You also see every single major company that has a developer suite of solutions, whether it's Facebook or Twitter or Yahoo, that is building tools for app developers to enable their users to share out content, to distribute it to their friends. And it's getting smarter and more efficient than ever before.
Let's talk about the elephant in the room, because someone is going to raise it if we don't. You know, this is a challenging time right now for advertising in general. There's a lot of discussion about ad blocking, the user experience, and sometimes, you know, on your mobile device, it can be like going through a swamp with different ad experiences and content. What do you guys think is a sustainable ad content experience? What do you guys see as the right way to handle you know, advertising, especially on this really personal device?
Again, it's, I think it's all about proportions, right? The average user uses their phone in 60-second increments. So you're working with that as your sort of, as your baseline. If the ad experience is 30% of that experience, it's gonna upset people, right? So it needs to be proportional to the time spent in the way that we use these devices. So I think the ads can't be too big. They have to be clearly marked. They have to be seamless in the environment. But in fairness to advertisers, they have to be seen. There is some, and we're doing some research on this, links between dwell time, the amount of time that the ad is in view, and brand recall and eventual brand purchase. So our ability to kind of put ads in a place where they would be exposed for a number of times without actually having to make someone click on it, I think is also something that that mobile has to look at, given the speeds at which people scroll and other things like that. But I think that, you know, like I said before, you have the consumer, you have the advertiser, you have the publisher, and they all, in order for the ecosystem to thrive, everyone has to be happy. So it's about finding that balance.
Right. It is a shared responsibility, and just a call to action. The IAB has put a ton of effort into you know, outlining what are some guidelines for the industry in terms of ad experience. Go to IAB.com and look at an initiative called Lean to learn more.
I'll just say quickly, I mean, we got rid of all the display ads in our apps because it's a video experience. We want you to watch a video. If you are a marketer and you sponsor the movie awards for MTV, and we actually work with you to create content, so one of our clients had a fan-based movie that they had made with mobile, we had that live within a native ad. So when you're going to an MTV page in the app, you've got our content, but there's also a tile that has our branding, but a fan-made piece of material that is brought to you by a client. So we're finding other ways to introduce brands to our fans without just saying click here and buy now.
Alex, any add on to that?
I think you guys have kind of captured it beautifully.
So have you, by the way.
No.
You've all done a good job. You too.
Well, so let's see if we've done a good job. I want to open it up to the audience, and I'm sure there are some questions. We have answered them all.
Were there any like acronyms? I know that when you get a bunch of monetization ad people on a stage,
we do have a question. Here we go.
Have any of you used the restrooms here with the screens on the faucets? So first of all, you said we can't sell what we can't measure. Are you measuring my dwell time at the sink?
Yes.
And second of all, what's been the reaction to those kinds of, that's a true IoT advertising thing as opposed to mobile, which is sort of zeroth generation IoT.
What's happening was at the sink and not anywhere else?
Well, actually, just one distinction that that I'm actively having to force myself, it's no longer like just a mobile experience, especially when you're talking about developers, it's app developers, because with the IoT, like app developers are now building for televisions, they're now building for watches, and they're also building for their smartphone experiences, so, and restrooms.
All right, I think that's all we have time for. Thank you, Ryan, and Alex, and Chris, and Pete. Any final questions? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.